Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, and welcome to Forest Hill Presbyterian Church. A few announcements for today. A reminder that session will meet after worship today in my office. So those of you who are staying for session, please remember that. Also, we are planning for an all-church retreat that will happen on Saturday, January 27th from 9 to noon. It is a time for us to reflect and to really lean into what our next steps are as a congregation. So it's a little bit of future thinking, but it's also looking at our past history and what it has to teach us, and also thinking about simply how we respond to God's grace in our lives. So for those of you who are here, you're invited, y'all come. For those who are not here, think about who's not here today, and I hope you'll extend an invitation to other church members to be a part of that reflection and that retreat. Are there any other announcements for this morning? Let us worship God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The voice of the Lord is over the waters.
The God of glory thunders, the Lord over the mighty waters.
The voice of the Lord is powerful.
The voice of the Lord is full of majesty.
And a voice came from heaven.
You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased.
Our first hymn for today is hymn number 150 in the red hymnal, As of Gladness.
Menable. grace God has poured out upon us and trusting in the future God has promised us, let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks and praise for the new thing you have done in Jesus Christ, our Savior. Baptized by John in the Jordan, you anointed him with your Holy Spirit and claimed him as your beloved Son. We give you thanks and praise that by the grace of our baptism, you have claimed us as well and poured out the gifts of your Spirit so that we might be dead to sin and alive to you in Christ Jesus. Continue to pour out your Spirit upon us. Empower us to love and serve you and live as your faithful people. Today, as we celebrate the baptism of the Lord, may we who have been baptized in his name never turn away from the world, but reach out in love to all. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
In this time of remembering our baptisms, we think about those times where we have had to turn from ways we knew that were not good for us. We repented, we turned around, we gave our lives to Christ again so that we might be renewed. Trusting in that grace to change us, we turn to God and confess our sin together. Eternal God, wondrous star, light no darkness can overcome, drive out the sin in our hearts. Forgive us for turning from your way, for denying your truth, for resisting the life you would have us live. Refresh us and restore us. Help us to remember our baptism and our participation in your mission in the world. Focus us on the brilliant light of Jesus Christ, that we may see him more clearly and follow him more nearly this and every day.
Thank you. You've got a bike.
Oh, yeah.
Well.
Were you
expecting those things?
No, not at all.
Oh. So it was a real surprise. Suppose you got a gift that you actually had expected. Would that be cool?
Yeah.
Yeah, if you were looking forward to something and it really arrived, well, who arrived on Christmas?
Let us pray. O Lord, you sent to us Jesus as a baby. Today we encounter him as he begins his ministry with the sign of baptism. Help us in this sign, in this sacrament, to see how you and the Holy Spirit continue to speak to us today. Help us to hear a word to us in your word, and help us to understand how we can be more fully connected to you. Amen.
Amen. I'm reading from the first chapter of Genesis, verses 1 through 5. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness night. And there was evening,
God.
Our psalm lesson today is one we're going to sing together, hymn number 10 in the red hymnal, Sing Glory to the Name of God.
God.
Into what have you been baptized? During the Apostle Paul's travels between Corinth and Ephesus, he runs into some followers of the way, believers in the earliest of Christian communities, and when he meets them, he asks, "Did you receive the Holy Spirit when you became believers?" Funny, they don't know what he's talking about. They don't even know who the Holy Spirit is. So Paul's follow-up question in the 19th chapter of Acts is this: "Well then, into what have you been baptized?" It's an intriguing question, a question we might even want to ask ourselves today. Into what were you baptized? Was it John the Baptist's original idea of baptism, a sign of repentance and transformation? Was it an affirmation in your heart, an outward sign that you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Was it your parents' idea to get you baptized, thus indicating a sign of unconditional grace that even babies are welcomed into the fold of God's love well before they can even make a decision to worship God themselves? Was it a get-out-of-hell-free card, a sign of the enduring belief that original sin must be countered by enacting this ritual blessing of the church, lest a person die unbaptized and end up unredeemed? Maybe you were baptized specifically for one of these reasons, or a combination of a few. Baptism carries both the baggage and the blessings of all of these messages in one way or another, some more specific to one brand of Christianity than the next. However, in the minds of those considering asking for this sacrament of the church, either for themselves or for others, most of these thoughts bump around into each other and have an enduring presence for a variety of spiritual or cultural reasons. So I'll ask you to pause for a moment with this question. Into what were you baptized? Paul insinuates that if you have been baptized into Christ Jesus, you will know, like experientially know, the Holy Spirit. Have you received something mysterious, meaningful, and life-changing? Have you been transformed by this experience? Do you know the radical grace of God's love for you, both deeply and personally? Well, do you? Paul, having had his mind blown and his whole life reoriented in this encounter with the resurrected Jesus on the Damascus Road, is intent upon promoting the mysterious grace that has changed him. His questions are probing, his message urgent, his faithfulness unwavering. If you are baptized into Christ Jesus, it better well mean something. So here we are on this first Sunday of 2024, and I'm asking you, using Paul's old question, to do a gut check on what being a follower of Jesus means to you. What does being baptized into the Church of Jesus Christ really mean to you? This happens to be a fiery exchange of words from Act 19, and though I didn't read it all as a text, you heard the highlights from what Paul and these early Christians were talking about. So let's now go back to rejoin Jesus and John on the banks of the Jordan River. At the beginning of our calendar year, the cycle of the lectionary reminds us that the powerful start of Jesus' active ministry begins with a spiritual awakening at the river. The Holy Spirit shows up. Baptism is her cue card to make a full appearance. Mark's Gospel, the oldest text of the four, tells us that as Jesus was coming up out of the water, the heavens were torn apart with the Holy Spirit descending like a dove upon him. This is the beginning, according to Mark. No lengthy genealogy like Matthew, no visit from the angel Gabriel, no Mary, no Joseph, no manger bed like Luke, no grandiose musings about about the word and the light like John. In the beginning, John the baptizer, the messenger foretold, appears in the wilderness, and boom, Jesus shows up to be baptized. John feels unworthy of this honor. For Jesus to come to him ready to accept this mantle of what his ministry is going to mean for himself and for all people everywhere. My friends, these are intense texts. So I hope that today you're getting a little flavor of that as I'm trying to help you see them that way. They make my sense of Christianity sometimes feel small and insignificant. They make me look around at the church in our current times and wonder if we have less of a clue about the Holy Spirit than those followers in Ephesus that Paul came to baptize with the Holy Spirit. How do I get a taste of that magnitude of power and spirit in my own sense of being? Especially when I was baptized more than 50 years ago as a baby. I don't remember it. Jesus commanded us to baptize in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Paul and the other early apostles saw this as a huge part of their ministry, but they also seemed to be baptizing these early converts into something. Into what? Now, I think it's something more than what our institutional fussings and arguments about baptism have become over the centuries. Do you dunk or do you sprinkle? Is it meant to cast out sin or be a sign of God's grace? Much ink and sometimes blood has been spilled over controversies about what baptism is supposed to mean to us. I say we need to go back to the intensity of texts like these to imagine a movement that was catching fire in the world where it began. If John the Baptist was humbly afraid of this honor, if Mark can tell us that the heavens were torn apart, if Paul can distinguish an empty baptism from a life-changing one, maybe that's more of what we need to pray for and imagine if the sleepy church is going to reawaken. We need to understand both the fear and the awe of spiritual renewal. Now, I happen to know a bit about the charismatic movements that were popular during my childhood in the 70s and that fed off a human desire to feel special and set apart. Those who were caught up in that fervor had good intentions, even if they sometimes led to some difficult kinds of outcomes, with church splits over speaking in tongues or healing ministries that promised way more than they were able to deliver. We can shrink away from such intensity in our spiritual lives in part because it is so polarizing. And the last thing we need in our current context is to exacerbate the extremes that are dividing people from one another and causing such pain. We think better to stay neutral, not rock the boat, not be too dramatic with our faith. But this thinking, my friends, can leave us apathetic, completely unfamiliar with the spiritual nature of what we're trying to do here. This isn't just a place to gather and hear a self-help lecture, nor is it only a community where we come together to do good things. If we are just those things, then baptism ceases to make sense. Why enact a ritual to represent repentance, transformation, and hope if we don't believe that the Spirit has much relevance? The spiritual awakening that we can witness in the pages of Scripture when the Word of God becomes God's Word to us is about the Spirit's presence within us and all around us. How often have you heard a Presbyterian sermon or any sermon really dive into the ways we experience the Holy Spirit? Have you heard any recently? No takers. Okay. It should feel a little dangerous, a little disturbing, a little bit like a change might be required of us. The Spirit is anything but predictable. You, and I'm assuming most of you like me, have been baptized in the Holy speaking in tongues and being able to prophesy. Now, I'm not looking for that. I'm not looking for some spark of change. Certainly, I look for it in myself, and I hope to look for it in all of us if we are to become awake and alive with the meaning of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ. Maintaining the mere institution of the church is just too dreadfully boring. We've been at it for so long, and I don't know about you, but it makes me tired. We were erroneously told that keeping the church alive will keep us alive. But Jesus tells us that we constantly have to be losing our lives, shedding the things that we know in order to save them. We have to have something we are truly putting on the line to live into the grace that he demonstrated in his life and ministry that began with the heavens torn apart and a rush of the Holy Spirit. Where is that energy? Where is that movement that inspired the early church? How do we taste the meaning of baptism in our own lives? These are deep and ongoing questions. They require us to be spiritually moved by the sacred ordinariness of life. Baptism is a water ritual. There's not a whole lot that's more common than that. Water is in and around everything. We ourselves, our human bodies are made of mostly water. And yet, it is our sign of spiritual change. The Spirit can bless us and be present with us in so many ways. Through music and art, through words of comfort or words of challenge, through the kindness of friends or a surprising encounter with a stranger, through nature and wonder and awe, through service and practice and showing up, through the heavens being torn apart or a troubled life being put back together. I want to be baptized into that kind of spiritual life. I want to know that the presence of the Spirit, the sense of the blessing of the living Christ, is here in our midst. But the hardest part for the church, the hardest thing we have to do, is to let go, to let it be. It's about letting go of whatever is getting in the way or holding us back. That's the reason John preached a baptism of repentance. We have to turn it around. We have to turn away from the things that are holding us back. Even Jesus himself, was baptized into the baptism that John was offering. Then the skies opened, and he heard this. "You are my beloved child. With you, I am well pleased." Don't we long to hear the same thing from our loving God? You are mine, and I love you. That's what we really need to know now, isn't it? Now, let's sing a spirit song, Spirit of the Living God, hymn number 288, a reminder of the Spirit's movement in us.
Spirit of the Living God,
affirmation of faith today comes from a brief statement of faith, the document that was created by the PCUSA in the early 90s, especially as rebirth was happening between the northern and southern branches of the Presbyterian Church. There's now a new committee to look at what else do we need to be saying in our world today that is looking at writing a statement of faith for today's church. So let us now come to this brief statement of faith. There's a leader part and a responsive part, so let us come to this together. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve.
We trust in God, the Holy Spirit, everywhere the giver and renewer of life. The Spirit justifies us by grace through faith, sets us free to accept ourselves and to love God and neighbor, and binds us together with all believers in the one body of Christ, the Church. The same Spirit who inspired the prophets and apostles rules our faith and life in Christ through Scripture, engages us through the word proclaimed, claims us in the waters of baptism, feeds us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation, and calls women and men to all ministries of the church. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of peoples long silenced, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace.
In gratitude to God,
empowered by the Spirit, we strive to serve Christ in our daily tasks and to live holy and joyful lives, even as we watch for God's new heaven and new earth, praying, "Come, Lord Jesus."
The Spirit inspires us to reach out in giving, to do what we can to proclaim Christ's mission and ministry in our world today. So with thanks in our hearts, let us bring to God our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Holy God, you accept the gifts that we bring, whether they are fine and fancy or simple and from the heart. We ask that you bless the gifts we bring today, gifts of our resources, gifts of our voices, gifts of our prayers. Collect them and use them for your purposes. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Let us pray. Spirit of the living God, you blessed us each in our baptisms, those of us who have been taken to the water and blessed with the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Know that that baptism is a gift to us. We pray for those who have yet to receive that gift, that those who are drawn to those waters will be compelled to come. Those who are parents of children will know the grace that is present there. We pray that we learn from your baptism, Jesus, that we can be open to all that God is gifting us to do, as well as you were open to all that the Holy Spirit gave you to do. May we continue to walk with the poor. May we continue to pray for healing for those who are sick. May we learn to visit those who are in prison, whether that's a formal prison or a prison of their own making, to sit with those who feel captive in chains. We pray for this community, this church, to listen for how you are calling it into its future. Enliven us with your Holy Spirit. Awaken us with your presence. Show us that the heavens continue to be torn apart so that they may bless this earth that we know. We pray for those places that feel broken or torn apart here in our world. We pray for wars to end. We pray for poverty to end. We pray for homelessness to end. But we know we all have a part to play in those events so that we're not just bystanders, but are continuing to work for your justice and righteousness in our world today. We lift up those who are in our hearts and on our minds today. You hear all our prayers, O God, so hear not only what my words have spoken, but what our hearts also tell you are true and where we need to be in our prayers with you today. Listen to our hearts in the silence.
Thank you.
Show me as we lift our voices and pray as Christ taught us to pray, saying, Our Father in heaven, holy is your name, your kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Friends, it is in the sacraments of the church where we meet Jesus Christ. We meet the Spirit in the waters of baptism. We meet Christ at this table, the one that he set for us, so that we not only know that repentance that comes through baptism, but we feel that renewed every time we come to the table and ask Christ to forgive us of our sins and renew us as we take him into us, so that we can take Christ out into the world. So I invite you today to this table that Christ has prepared. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, O Lord our God, creator and ruler of the universe. You formed us in your image and set us in this world to love and serve you. Today we celebrate both Epiphany that happened on Saturday and Jesus' baptism that we celebrate today. These are those times when you manifest your light upon the world so that as we recognize in Christ God made visible, we may be caught up through him in love for all. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the choirs of angels and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name.
Thank you.
that they may be for us the body and blood of Christ, and that we may be his body for the life of the world. Strengthen in faith and love your pilgrim church on earth. By your Spirit, unite us with Christ and with one another until we feast with him and with all your saints in the eternal realm of justice and peace. May Christ's coming in glory find us ever watchful in prayer, strong in truth and love, and faithful in the breaking of bread. Then at last all peoples will be free, all divisions healed, and with your whole creation we will sing your endless praise. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, forever and ever.
Let us pray. O Lord, you have fed us at this table until we are able to dine with you at the heavenly banquet. Continue to nurture us in faith. Help us to live into our baptisms. Help us to trust as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we will be renewed by the power of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our concluding hymn today is hymn number 482, Baptized.